Hey, there's bad words and other things in this. Okay, bye.
All right, this is what's up. Spaz doesn't let me out to play too often, so you shitheads better pay attention. My name is Savior Dominus. I am the rage buried deep within that fanboy's weak little soul. Up until that last video. Hey! What the hell are you doing? I told you to pay attention and you're nodding off to Dreamland? Come here! Are you gonna fall asleep while I'm talking? Are you gonna fall asleep while I'm talking? Good! Now we can discuss that which summoned me. Creature from the Black Lagoon, the musical. But thanks to that little twit, you already know it sucks, meaning less work for me. What he may not have told you is that it dropped into the Castle Theater after Fear Factor got the boot. But is Spaz right? Was the show really that bad, or am I living proof that he blew his load too early? Well, speaking from experience, that happens all too often anyway, but let's see if I'm right and this sends me on a murderous rampage. We open on a pre-recorded segment of the Today Show, hosted by White Oprah and her horny co-host.
One fine lady ichthyologist. You know, you'd think they'd put some pictures of her right here.
Come on, calm down, jeez.
The reason for the cross-promotion is to tell the dimwits stupidly seeing this tripe about an expedition to the real Black Lagoon, which inspired the movie, which in turn inspired the show, which is about the real Black Lagoon, which inspired the movie, which is about the show. And what's this? A musical number in a musical? I'm shocked that anything could be so stupid! I'm serious, listen to this lyric!
From the Disney cruises, flee from the mafia!
First of all, the standard size of a Disney cruise liner is roughly 1,100 feet long and 120 feet wide. The filming location for the lagoon itself is half that size and landlocked, so of course they would flee, you dumb fuck. Second of all, enough with the Disney bashing! Every chance you get, you take it. We know they're your competition. We've understood that for quite some time. We don't need it shoved down our throats, but that's fine. This song also has the displeasure of introducing us to the assholes of the production. Meet Smuggy, who's after money, Nerdy, who's after knowledge, and Not So Pretty, who's after cock. For going the several decades, women have fought to be portrayed as equals amongst their male counterparts. I hope you die. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I reveal a spoiler? Grow up, would you? This is the fucking internet. And I'm not alone here. Listen to the audience when they finish the song. I have a few theories as to why this happened. The audience probably didn't expect the song to end that way, despite it having a basic structure of rising and falling action, thus making everyone in attendance dumber than a doornail, or they were just too horrified to warrant any immediate reaction. If that's the case, then they're a bunch of pansies. Absolutely nothing could have prepared them for the horror they were about to witness.
Hey, we are scientists. We're not here for romance.
It's like I'm back in high school. I understand that it was a stage production at the low-rent Disneyland, but even Spider-Man wasn't this bad. In fact, Spider-Man somehow worked! It's somewhat impossible to have a guy in bright red form-fitting tights fight another guy in a bargain bin Halloween costume and not look ridiculous. However, it is very possible for a horror musical to be subtle and atmospheric.
At last, my arm is complete again!
Well, maybe not subtle, but they managed to get their point across without resorting to dumbing down the content. And I spoke too soon. And it's an homage of the iconic swimming scene from the film! Of course. I wonder if this one's about how she's yearning for romance in this exotic location.
Just how to live my time.
how wonderfully predictable. And it appears she's also using it as a euphemism for suicide. I happen to know an expert in career suicide. Let's give him a call. Hey! Gilman look like the Predator!
You're one ugly motherfucker.
You know, it's about this time that any other self-respecting reviewer would ask, could it get any worse? But I'm not, so I won't. Just watch how worse it gets.
Can I get a hug too?
Oh, I thought you'd never ask.
Oh wait, oh.
Keep in mind, there are kids in the audience.
This is all right, but whatever!
What a horrible monster musical!
You're not supposed to agree with me! What was that?
Look out! He's going to sing!
Why would he sing? He never spoke.
What the hell are you doing around here? Cause I'm a Darth Vader, Freddy Krueger, OJ Moby, yeah!
Awful lyrics aside, why is he singing?! Gilman never talked. That's what made him threatening. He was more than a fish, but not quite a man. He stalked his prey with efficient stealth, all without talking. Yet here he is, belting out melodies like a Rastafarian swamp thing.
We gotta save him from that creature from the black lagoon.
Fuck you. And then they go full Monty on us. Sure, whatever. I don't give a shit anymore. I don't. Oh, and Not So Pretty wants to fuck the creature. Well, that's just special. Oh, but you can't forget to throw a little Spanish in there, even though half the audience doesn't understand it. Yeah. What the fuck? Clearly this is the point where any semblance of worldly logic goes completely down the shitter. Any poor soul going into this, assuming it would be a musical take on the 1953 horror classic, would be sorely mistaken by now. Because this is not Creature from the Black Lagoon. It's Beauty and the Beast. Making that two, count them two, slights against Disney in one attraction. Oh, but we're not quite finished yet. Once they establish Ditzy and Dorky's rocky relationship, anyone using a fraction of functioning brain cells knew this was coming. I somehow convinced myself they wouldn't go there, because it's like Spazzy Boy said earlier, there's no way they could be that stupid. Well, batten down the hatches, because it only gets infinitely more retarded from here. And why am I still in a bathroom? Why, you little...
Just so you know, I didn't do this because you cracked wise at me. I'm making sure you have enough cranial blood flow to understand what you're about to see, okay? Okay.
So Bob Snarly here takes the dits in distress away to his cove.
Now, a piece of advice, and because I want to be fair, resist every temptation this throws in front of you.
Look at this stuff. Isn't it neat? Wouldn't you think my collection's complete?
Look. I'm already dealing with a big-breasted bimbo and an out-of-character creature. I don't need you mouthing off and not listening to me. Besides, Gilman has a monocle.
And it's pretty bad when even the self-aware characters are confused.
What exactly are you?
A walking venereal disease.
This is crazy! I'm an ichthyologist!
What?
I'm an ichthyologist!
No, you're not.
I'm an ichthyologist!
You can say it as slow as you want. It won't make it any less false.
Ichthyologist!
Stop! Jeez! Okay, let me explain, because I know a few of you morons are still clueless, so I'll try not to use big words. This woman is not an ichthyologist. Hell, I'm surprised the character can pronounce ichthyologist. But this would be an easier pill to swallow if she fucking acted like one! For a moment, let's analyze her associates. Smuggy, again, is only in this for the money. But what douchebag scientist isn't? Besides, he is actively on the hunt for his big break. Nerdy? Well, I don't think he can be more obvious. He's so engrossed by and in constant awe of the environment, I half expect to see him with a rock-hard erection. With a show like this, it wouldn't be out of place either. But this wench, this ichthyologist, all she craves is fish sticks. Okay, I'll give you that. Anyway, you son of a... Oh, right, I kinda need you alive.
You good? Don't do that again.
Anyway, in case you didn't see it coming, it's Gil and Not So's obligatory love ballad. And Gilman has a microphone. Well, clearly it's so we can hear even more awful lyrics. And like a biker chick's tattoo. Alright, did the songwriters have a hard-on for analogies? That's literally all of Gilman's lyrics. Honey, you pose any harder, that ass is gonna pop right out those dukes. But it's weird. This is the only song number that showcases the actor's actual singing abilities. I'm serious, they're giving it their all here. So, maybe I was wrong. Maybe this isn't all that bad. Oh, fuck you! This was the first legitimately tolerable part of the show, and I was willing to give it a chance, but no! This attraction just sucks any shred of enjoyment out of every second spent watching it! But thank the good Lord above! We are almost finished. Smuggy and Nerdy find Gil's secret underwater hideout, somehow, and rescue Not So Pretty. But not before Smuggy plants a harpoon in the creature's chest cavity. You know, given that I know the consequences of this incident, I'm willing to take it as a win. However, rather than being stricken with an overwhelming amount of "Holy shit, I just met a talking fish man, I must study the fuck out of it," she pines over her newfound forbidden love. Even after he becomes a giant.
I accidentally dropped the spear into this.
A-Rod's human growth hormone.
Whatever, we're almost done. Not So goes native, donning a jungle one piece, reprises Strange New Hunger, and finally gets what she deserves. One more reprise later, and then it's over. So, here are my final thoughts. This isn't just bad. This is the type of god-awfulness that transcends legend. The kind of mythical wretchedness spoken about in hushed tones by tourists from all walks of life. You can't believe something so heinous could exist, but when you see it, you wish it didn't. As a theme park attraction, I'd rather endure Small World 1,000 times over. As a comedy horror musical, I'd rather watch Cannibal or Poultrygeist. And in terms of its content, the combined works of Michael Bay and Ron Jeremy have more class. Forget Ghost Dad, Howard the Duck, or freaking Battleship. This is the worst thing Universal has ever produced. But you know what's really, really fucked up about this? It almost could have... This show was nearly...
Creature from the Black Lagoon, the musical.
Should never have existed, so I'm going back in time to make sure it doesn't.
Second thoughts?
Oh no, an internal struggle between you and a dark version of yourself. How pathetically predictable.
Who said this was happening in your head?
Hello, sweetie.
Darling, I'm actually surprised to see you here.
You're not gonna do it.
And how do you know that?
You sent me the script. Besides, I know you.
You know that weakling. Not me.
Maybe so, but I know the man I fell in love with is still in there. Ain't that right, baby?
Uh-huh.
Yep. I knew you couldn't resist this plot point.
What can I say? It's what I do best.
Yeah, recycling your old material. I commend your originality.
You're cracking.
You be quiet!
Face it, Ragey. There is no version of this where you come out on top.
Yeah, and I'm always angry. I can quote the Avengers, too.
Mewling Quim.
Shut up!
My point is, you've given this some thought and come to a conclusion that contradicts everything you're about. A conclusion you didn't come to on your own. You need me, Savio. Without me, you're nothing. And in turn, I'm nothing without you. We're a duo. A duo. A pair of lonely ones who were meant to be a two.
All right.
Excellent. Gonna let me out now?
No, I'm gonna cancel that stupid program.
That does it! Finish the review, dear.
Yes, ma'am.
Still can't believe that works.
Well, I love you no matter how pissed off I get. I like this.
Review.
Got it. There's no denying this show sucked. But in some freaky, backwards way, it actually kind of worked. It still would have remained fairly short-lived, but somewhat more appealing. After all, it is a universal monster, albeit a B-lister, but still a recognizable one. They could have kept it a musical, and it still could have had potential. Hell, keep the innuendos. Fine. I know this sounds crazy, but it was perfectly acceptable the way it was, but not with the normal crowds they were attempting to reach. I knew the one and only time I saw this, it felt like something I would see during Halloween Horror Nights. Might have been a few lewd and gory articles short, but it still would have fit. The Creature from the Black Lagoon is a campy drive-in 3D flick from the start. Why not play it up for the dumb, drunken patrons who don't know any better? They don't care. That's half the reason they come. Cheap scares, cheap insult comedy, and overpriced booze. However, what this show did well, it did really well. Mainly the set design. I mean, it freaking looked like the movie. And that massive Gilman puppet was the best example. And yes, there were a few moments where the performers wowed me with their pipes. Holy crap, could they sing! And a few of the lyrics did manage to get a chuckle out of me. In the end, though, it just didn't work for me. It was a show out of its element, maybe its own time, and was closed after only 8 months. Yet I'm the only one who cared enough to be traumatized by it.
Babe?
God, I'm glad this will be gone by the time I do the Blitz job of Fornia. In the year 2035.
Oh, yeah. You can let go now.
Okay, how often do I get to do this?
Good point. So with Kong gone and the epic failure of Creature looming over their heads, they went back to their roots. And in 2010, the special effects stage premiered in the Castle Theater. But I'm gonna save that for the next part.
Wait, you're not discussing the crapped up Freudian subtext and how incredibly critical this is of women and—
Babe, trust me, after this I'm gonna need some sort of holiday.
Okay.
So, yeah. See you in part 4.